So now we're going to talk about sample management. So let's look at the Digitakt 2 first and just take a look at the samples I've got loaded onto this. So if I go to my plus drive, you can see I've got all these folders. These ones are samples from Mars. So I've got the 606 and 808. I've got some live set stuff. That's the factory folder. I've got like a jungle breaks pack. The one that I have kind of curated myself is in this folder here, and it's the Digi sample. So this was a folder that I put together when I first got my Digitakt. And what I did was I actually spent 2 weeks putting this together, and I used Splice and some other websites to kind of curate my own sample pack selection, if that makes sense, including some of the samples that I've actually made myself as well. So if you go into kick, you can see I've got like Boys Noise kick snare, a left. I've actually got like D-Cat for Jack, all these different kicks I've got from different packs, Hodge. A lot of them are like artist ones. The JO ones are the ones that I've created before. These are actually ones that I created for Novation, for one of their circuit machines, I think it was. Yeah, I did like 3 packs for Circuit like ages ago when Circuit 2 was about to come out. And I did a techno pack, electro pack, and a Chicago house pack. So I made loads of bass drums, made loads of snare drums for that, and so on. But you can see there's a structure to the way that I curate my samples. So you can see I've got kicks, snares, claps, rim shots, hats, cymbals, toms, percussion, bass, synth, vox, atmosphere, and effects. Took me a long time to put together, but it was so useful. And I'm going to talk you through how I kind of curated this. You don't have to do any of this, because what you can do is basically just grab any old sample pack and chuck it in there. But this was a bit of a time saver for me in the long run. So you can see what I've done is for each of these, I've labeled them with numbers in the order that I want to see them. So I want to see a kick, snare, clap, rim shot, hat as I go down. And then you can see within these as well that all of the files are labeled properly. So all bass drums will start with BD underscore. Then it will have the pack location where it's come from. And then it will have the file name for that kick drum in this example. So you can see we've got 808 distortion. But then right at the very end of the label, you'll see that they are numbered. And then after the numbering, they then have a key, which is so useful when you're creating tracks. So the way that I did this was actually using a rename app. Let me just jump over to the desktop and have a look. So File Renamer Pro, it could be this. Have I actually got, yeah. So I use File Renamer Pro. I think I bought that on the Apple Store. And the way that works is you basically drop in a sample. Let's go to my samples and drop something in. So if I go to SSD samples, there's my Digitakt folder there. And then let me just go File Renamer Pro and just see if I can drop that straight in there. It's not letting me. So let me just go to my, in fact, I think I could do it this way. Watch, you can go File, Open, and then I think you can open a folder. It's been a long time since I used this. So if we go to SSD samples, we go to the sample folder. Let's go to Octa samples. Let's just go to that. Let's say if we chose this kick drum folder and I opened it, it would populate it with all of the kick drums that are in that folder. By the way, these are the same kick drums. They're just formatted for the Octatrack. So instead of them being 24-bit, the 16-bit, just little things like that, instead of 48 kilohertz, they're actually 44.1. But you can see that it's got a before and an after. And what I can do is I can go into the top there and set different things. So you can basically replace certain words. So what I could do is replace all the occurrences of BD with, let's say, a kick. And then you can see if I run this and press play, it will change all of the file names. So instead of saying BD, it starts with kick. You could also like add text after, remove all occurrences of, maybe I want to go remove all the underscores, and now it's removed all the underscores. And there's loads of different things that you can do. It goes quite deep. There's a lot of stuff there. You can remove dates, add bullet points, all that kind of stuff. It's so useful when creating sample packs or creating file directories that you're going to put on a sampler. So a little bit nerdy, a little bit kind of like OCD, but it's definitely worth doing. It will save you a lot of time in the long run, trust me. So yeah, we've got that going on. If you buy any packs for me, always know that they'll always be labeled correctly. I always make sure that they are listed like this, and it makes it easier for you when you're looking for a sample. On the Digitakt itself, if you want to auto preview these, what you can do is you can hit right and go all the way to the bottom and go on auto preview. And let's just have a listen to some of these. So you can hear my kicks there. And what you'll also notice as well is that they are all the same mix level. And we'll come on to this in a second, because I think it's a really important point to get across. Now, I know we're going a bit deep and a bit geeky on this, and it's supposed to just be an overview of sample management, but this is how I manage my samples. So what I'm going to do now is just come away from this and go back to the desktop. What I'm going to show you is I'm going to take a kick drum in Ableton. I'm going to take, in fact, actually, no, we'll do it on, yeah, let's do it on the Digitakt. It's going to be a lot easier. Right, so what I'm going to do is just load up a sample on each of the tracks. So let's go into my Digitakt one. Let's take, actually I need to come out of that. Let's go into source. And let's add a kick drum. Any old kick drum. Let's just put that on 1, 5, 9 and 13. And then let's go to the track 2. And let's load another sample. So I won't go crazy, we'll just load like a kick, a hat, a snare, because otherwise it's going to take too long to do this. Hat. And you'll understand why I'm doing this in a second. So let's load a hat and just do a basic pattern. And then let's go and add on 3, let's add maybe a snare or a clap. So we'll do a clap actually. Clap. Don't even know what I'm selecting here, but just putting them in randomly. I think that will do, and then maybe just the percussion sound as well, just to kind of showcase what I'm trying to do here. So if we go to track 4. Let's add a percussive sound, any old sound, and I'll just put kind of dot it around like this. That will do. No, what we're going to do now is we're going to leave that running, and we're going to go over to Ableton. And I'm just going to look at this Pro Q, but what I'm going to do is just boost up the volume a little bit until my kick drum touches the line. And let's just turn it down a little bit on here to counteract that increase. So you can see my kick drum is now on the line. Let's just solo that. I know we're going a little bit off piece there talking about fab filter and stuff, but this is how I basically mixed all the drums in this pack, right? So just a quick background thing on the Pro Q, right? So Pro Q, the reason why I use it all the time, and I've covered this in many, many videos, so please feel free to skip this bit if you already know what I'm about to say. But any EQ usually will have a readout with no tilt on the readout here, and you'll see what I mean. So look how high the kick is compared to the hats now. It's got like a slope going down like this. If you put the slope on a 4.5 degree tilt, it takes that EQ curve and it just puts it horizontal. What that means is, if you mix to the line visually, you will create a mix that is around 80 to 90% good in terms of level balances. Obviously, there's a bit more to mixing than that, but it gives you a good volume set for the sounds. And that's what I did for the pack. So if we just solo each individual sound, you can see the kick's on the line there. The hats are just a little bit over, because when I mix techno and stuff, I like the hats to just be a little bit over, especially in electro as well. And then you can see the claps just almost touching the line. And then that top frequencies in that sound kind of hit the line as well. And it just means that whatever I chuck into this pattern on the Digitakt, it means that I know that it's going to be already pretty much mixed. And I maybe have to just make a couple of decibels of changes to make it sound good, and that is it. And it just makes everything really easy to mix. I can prove this by going into the samples that I've selected and just choosing completely different samples. So let's come back out again. And then for 3, let's choose different clap. And then for the 4th one, which was the percussion sound, let's just choose something else. Let's have a listen. So if you look at Pro Q again, you can see pretty much mixed already, tonally balanced and nicely mixed. And this is a different way to doing it, how people normally do it, because I've seen people make sample packs, and what they do is they try and push the level so everything is normalized and everything is slamming. But all that means, what that means is, in reality, what you're going to do is you're going to have kicks that are slamming, but then you're also going to have like snares and hats and stuff that are just way too loud. So you always have to turn them down. Whereas when you do it this way, you know that you've got a really nice tonal balance across the instruments. So that's why I made this pack this way, so that even if I do it on the fly at a gig, I know that all of my sounds are already mixed. So I can just make a drum beat on the fly and I know it's going to be mixed without me having to mess about. So it's just a time saver. I wanted to show you that because it's really important. If you're looking at creating your own little curated packs to put on your Digitakt, then this is a good technique to use. The other thing that I did as well when I did this was I also EQ'd some of the sounds as well, because sample packs are not always perfect, unless it is just basically like a raw pack that's been taken from a drum machine or something, and then that still needs a bit of sweetening. But with all of these, I ran them through slit, tape and channel, added a little bit of compression to some of them. A lot of them I did sculpt out the low frequencies below 20 hertz and just corrected any tonal imbalances, especially in kicks as well. I always EQ my kicks. So a lot of the kicks were already EQ'd before they went in. So even though it's a curated pack, I have made a lot of changes to the samples. Sorry, I know that's quite a lot to take in so early on in this course, but the other thing as well is the actual level that I sent these out of Ableton. If we go to, say, this kick drum here and just play that at unity, which is at zero, and let's look at the master, you will see that pretty much all of them around the kicks, because they're like the kicks and the bass are the loudest instruments and subs, they always seem to hit around minus 6 dB, and that's just the kind of level that I went for. Whereas obviously some packs, they are at unity at like, sorry, not unity, but they're always like hitting minus 0.2 dB. They're absolutely maxed out, especially like Vengeance packs and stuff like that. But I wanted to make it a bit safer to work with, so it wasn't going to rip the inputs of like the Octatrack once I send it through. So I balanced them like that. And then with export settings, if you're going to export stuff out of Ableton, I was exporting my samples out at, 48 on the sample rate. I was also working in 48 as well, 48K. And then I was exporting them out at 24-bit WAVs. And then you don't need to use Diver. Actually, let me just check, because I don't think they are that. I think it's 16-bit. Yeah, my bad, I got that wrong. So yeah, it's 16-bit on the bit depth. So what you do is you put it at 16-bit. But if your samples were previously 24-bit, then I would recommend adding some Diver. I won't go too much into the science of Diver, but basically rule of thumb is if you are coming down from a higher bit rate, you want to use a bit of Diver. I usually just go for triangular. I did some reading on this quite a while ago. I can't remember why, but it's just the rule of thumb. I always stick to it. No Diver unless I'm going down a bit rate, and then I'll stick it on triangular. If you're just loading sample packs straight into the Digitakt, you don't need to worry about any of this, because transfer just does it automatically anyway. In terms of processing as well, if you're batch processing a lot of samples, there is also some batch audio processing tools out there. I'll probably link some in the video description down below, maybe give you some links to like File Renamer Pro and just some other tools that I use as well. And if I've missed stuff out, I'll just write it down below the video in the description. It's going to get too long if I go into absolutely everything about audio editing. So yeah, let's move on from this now. So if we take a look at transfer now, what you want to do is you want to go into your explore page, and you can go to samples, and then you can create a folder. So if you go create folder, you can create a folder that looks like these. The way that I've done it is previously with the first ever samples that I put on the Digitakt, you will notice that they're in these silly folders called transfers with dates on them. But then since then, I've started doing it properly. And the proper way to do it is to just drop it in this section here. You can drop a folder in there, or you can create a folder as a directory and drop it in. If you go to the drop page and just bang a folder straight into this area, which a lot of people do, including myself, then you end up with these weird transfer folders. And I've just never took them out in case I mess up the directory and Digitakt can't find these samples anymore, because I've got a lot of projects that are using these. That's pretty much it. If you want to move any of these around or rename them, you can do it actually on the Digitakt, but I prefer to do it all on... Actually, no, at this point, I would have to rename these within, because If I rename them outside the Digitakt now and drop them back in, they're going to have different file names. So any changes you would want to make them actually within the Digitakt itself. I wouldn't recommend it though. So yeah, we've got that going on. If you want to back anything up, obviously it's the same as before. Just make a folder like this one here. You could just go create folder, samples. So we've got projects above it, which we did in the last video. And then if you just want to like take a few samples out or anything like that, you can just kind of go like this and just drag them over like that. Or if you want to do a full backup, which I usually do, then you can take a full folder and drop it into a backup folder. And that's pretty much it. It's really simple. Let's move back over to the Digitakt now and just finish off with looking at some of this other stuff that we've got in here. So once you're in a folder and you're looking at the samples, you can then click right and actually we're in the wrong, we're still in the assign folder. What we want to do is go to function, samples, plus drive. Then we can go to a folder and then we're presented with some more options. So with this, what we can do is we can load it to project, which will load it to an empty sample slot. We can select all of the samples and then maybe like load it to project. We can deselect them all. We can move the selected around. So we can move samples around actually on the Digitakt too. We can rename them, delete them. We can also actually create folders. So it's my first time kind of looking at all this because they have updated a lot of stuff from the Digitakt one. So you can actually create a folder on there and you can also upload here as well. And auto preview, which is one I've been using a lot, means that you can preview all the samples. That's pretty much it for the plus drive. And then project RAM, obviously this is all of the sample slots. So the way that I work on the Digitakt is that I create a pattern. Once I'm in the pattern and I start populating these, I do what I did before, which is to choose a track, go down, find an empty sample slot, press yes, go find a sample. Maybe I'll go in here and choose a snare drum, colored snare drum, body, maybe choose that one. Come back out and then I can sequence that. And that's how I normally work. And then I end up with like a pool full of samples. You can be a little bit more organized if you want. And I was thinking about this before, like I could potentially have A as like kick drums and B as snares and so on. You could be a little bit more organized or you could just do it as I'm doing it now. If you go into the function and samples project RAM folder, that is the same folder that was just on, but again, you have a little bit more control over what to do with those samples. Also, you have an option to dump a lot of samples in there at once, and it's just good for organizing. Maybe when you start a fresh project, you know what sample libraries and folders you want to chuck in the pool. You can do that if you want to organize it in there. But I recommend just doing it as you go. I think that's like the best way, really.